last time I opened up a seed pod in order to better see the face of God. This time it seems shut to me, so I'm just going to shut it and walk over here and keep staring at the view. All right, awesome. Look at that view. It's got wires piercing out into the heavens like antennas. I'm sure that some sort of independent, popular piece of music could be written from this. And, well, it would be independent. No saying it would be popular, so, yeah. I'm sorry about the popping in of the scenery, probably because I have settings down. I guess it is a little distracting, ain't it? Yeah. But, hey, that's just how it is. So, yeah, there's some books I could read if I wanted to read a book, but, like, that sounds like work, so instead I'm gonna go over here. Aw, yeah. And so forth. Oh, and I don't even get a loading screen. How is it possible? I demand. Well, I'm probably not going to get an answer, so yeah. Now, I don't actually know very much about this place because this is about where I left off on my... off-camera sort of playthrough. This reminds me a lot of Myst 3, which some people are like, psh, Myst 3, but I thought it was a pretty good game. I don't know. I like Brad Dourif. He's kind of unhinged in his characters, except when he plays that one guy in Dishonored who is just kind of like, hi, I'm Brad Dourif. I'm kind of just completely wasted in this utterly quiet, Fluttershy-ish role. Anyway, okay, actually, it looks like I'm blocked off straight away, so this actually might just be a little preview. Hey, well, you just never know when you're flying blind or moving a mouse around blind. Either way, I'm sure some aviation is going to happen. Wait a minute. What are you doing here? Nothing. It's just kind of lighting up the place. Because you always gotta destroy the natural world by putting this darned artificial lighting everywhere. Darn it. Wait a minute. Am I still in the desert? Because there's some deserty rock over there, but it definitely looks like I'm not in a desert. I mean, I don't know, just like figuratively, of course. Oh, hey. That kind of reminds me of Twilight Princess again for some reason. So... yeah, okay, so this place, I can't do anything in this place, like, ever. This really reminds me of that super amazing Bird Isle jungle place in Myst 3. Exile. Anyways, okay, well, enough buggering about. I really thought that this was going to be a big old new super reveal, but look at it, it's beautiful. And that reminds me of Disney's Tarzan. Okay, I'm done being reminded. Let's go back and attempt to solve puzzles. That's rather disturbing that now I have to go back and think, comma, again. I was hoping to not have to think this episode. Brain power. It's a precious natural resource. Oh, I'm not. Excuse me. This is a cool effect. I mean, how do they even do that? It's amazing what you can do with graphics tech and sort of predicting the future by having particles fall into place. I don't know, but I can click that spot. That's funny. Probably unintentional. Oh yes, there's no loading screen because this is the loading screen, that's right. But, yeah, never mind, at least it's more interesting than the spinny circle. So, that was a bust. But, wasn't there some other place up here that I haven't been? Oh. Did I not just come this way? Oh my god, Finn. Seriously. Yeah, I don't know. I'm getting a little distracted by that popping myself, but, well. Oh well. Oh, well, what do you know? Even with everything on high, it still pops. So I guess never mind my smart comment there. But yeah, you don't want that, because then that happens. Anyway, back to walking through the hell corridor. If we get the God Pixel, we might be able to go to heaven. God loves pixels. That's why he whispered in our waiting ears to create the PC. And thus, everyone was pleased, I'm sure. Okay, so I can't even... Oh, I can. Okay, so yet another code. Oh, what? There's only three... There's only three numbers, you guys. What is happening? Oh, man. Oh, man. You know what this means, right? It means I'm gonna have to go back and probably figure out that Vortigaunt puzzle. With the slightly unfortunately shaped diamond control panel with blobs on it. Looks like that may be my only option. Unfortunate. Okay, well, that's okay, because we got these little metro hallways here. Yeah. Disappointed that soda pop is fizzing between my ears, but that's okay. Okay, yeah, unless I can figure out that number there. It's gotta be something to do with this spotty spot. Also, there's one other place that I ain't been, so if you wanna put on your propeller cap and follow me into the land of science and love. Well, the land of science and love is right up here, so, yeah. There's this little dory door over here, which I think actually is the place that was circled on that map place. But I can't get in. Even though there's power, I can't get in. I don't know what's in there. It's got some old school lanterns. I don't know. But, sure are a lot of doors. Anyway, let's see if I can't somehow figure out more stuff about this puzzle, which... I don't know, man. I might just have to, pretend. Wow, that thing is so freaking frightening. I mean, I know it doesn't look like I'm frightened. I'm just like, hey, I'm just walking by it. Wow, it sure is frightening. But it sure is frightening, okay? So given this has three digits, I think this might be giving me the code to that one door I just found with three digits on it. So, there's actually a pattern to this. Wow, this is difficult, and I'm not going to be able to solve it tonight, but it... kind of goes like it's base three, so every three digits have a representation kind of here in the middle. So that's one, this is two, this is three, and then four. But then every time it rolls over to a new, you know, four thing, some other connection happens, and then when you start incrementing from that, it does the same thing there. There's one, two, three, and then we get to another four rollover, in which case it kind of does the same pattern, but bumped up one over there. So it, if one... Oh, so yeah, the first one, the ones digit is like there, and then the tens digit, as it were, gets bumped up into the left there. But I don't know what the pattern is for that, but I do know 64 is that, which is what I want for making this five-looking symbol there. And that stays like that all the way up to, oops, all the way up to 127. So they've got some strange other pattern going on as well. I think you're supposed to write this stuff down on a physical, real-life piece of paper. Because, I mean, like, look at this. It's like they're teasing you. They're telling you to write stuff down, but you can't do it digitally. Oh, my God, you guys. I just don't know. I'm going to have to solve this really slowly and annoyingly, so this is going to be kind of a short video. So, while we're on the topic of shortness, Perhaps I can go back and read a little something. Also, maybe I should go back and reread some stuff I read already to see if I can get some clues. But, well, hey, why not head back to home community center base out of this horrible downtown area and read about some species. Yes, indeed. Also, there's no sh in species, but hey, nobody needs to know that. I wonder if there's any other clues around here. I don't know, but that's gotta be a three-digit number, I reckon. It just has to be. So, here's some species description. I don't know, perhaps we might find something fun. Mofang. Through ambassador seeds, the Mofang were the first non-human species humans were introduced to. An Liang was the first to call the alien a Mofang, impressed with their advanced ability to imitate our sounds, movements, and mannerisms. Although they have a name for themselves, their language is mostly unpronounceable by humans. As a result, and because of their mimicry abilities, communication with the Mofang is primarily accomplished by their learning human languages rather than humans learning to speak Mofang. They have been able to learn almost every human language represented in Hunrath enough to provide functional, if rudimentary, communication. The Mofang basic external morphology is remarkably humanoid. Bilateral symmetrical tetrapods, bipedal, head with anterior facial features, mouth, eyes, nostrils. Other external features include minimal body hair and raised dorsal protrusions. Constitution is somewhat frail, due apparently to their thin and lightweight internal structure, but internal investigation has not been possible. They have ample cranial space to account for a substantial brain, and their intelligence is impressive, as evidenced by their advanced technology. And there is one. Isn't he cute? He kind of sewed himself up there, but hey. No matter, I'm sure that, we've all been there. Alright, after a certain level of maturity and health of the tree, a passage opened at its base. As you do, this passage allowed contact with two additional species. The first contact was with the Ari. The first contact revealed the Ari to be large beetle-like insects. We were unable to communicate directly with them in any way, but they appeared to have some rudimentary level of intelligence. It was Lorink Toth who first made the journey through the heart to Kaptar and named both the new world and the inhabitants. The Ari have three distinct variants that have come to be referred to as Barnacle, Beetle, and Polyarch. Although their morphology is dramatically different from human, their internal systems, like all of our neighbors, are supported by similar atmospheric composition and basic nutrients. In their barnacle stage, the Ari are completely immobile. The Ari stay in this egg-like development state, seemingly indefinitely. In order to hatch, they must be in proximity of a polyarch and fertilized by the beetles after a certain stage of maturity. The beetles are the eyes and ears, hands and feet. With only a minimal nervous system of their own, they are essentially the sensory extensions of the immobile polyarchs. They are able to execute simple commands, but apparently have very little in the way of individual sentience. And there is one. How frightening. Looks rather like that deep-sea giant pill bug kind of creature. I don't know. The Ari polyarchs are the intelligence and consciousness of the species. Although it was obvious that there was intelligence behind the species, it wasn't until Caroline Farley began spending large amounts of time in close proximity that deeper communication began. With a room nearby, Farley was the first to communicate non-verbally and learn much about the species, including some historical information. The Ari species survived in their world while several other sentient species came and went. Among them, an ancient species who formed a deeper relationship with the Ari, carving temples and dwellings for them in the rocks. And later, a more recent species that took over much of their homeworld. This latter species was especially adept at mechanical construction, using it mostly to capture and process large flying creatures, using the beetles as bait. And there's some bait. Ugh. Jeez. Villian. The final species to be discovered were the Villian. The Villian had been communicating with the Ari for many years through ambassador seeds, but became part of the larger community very shortly after the Ari. With a large and imposing frame, and a form of communication based on a complex, multi-voiced, low-frequency rumble, the initial introductions were intimidating. After several attempts, Amelie Vidal was able to begin some rudimentary communication and began visiting the Villian in Marais, which she named on a regular basis. She discovered a complex and amazing society that was able to use their technology in unexpected ways. They had the ability to quickly transform their world using extruded structures based on some form of complex miniature substrate material. Unlike the other worlds, the Villian sphere is scooped out of a Villian resettlement group that was preparing to set off into space to find a new homeworld. This was their way of life, to put themselves into stasis and scatter themselves through the stars. As mentioned previously, their appearance is imposing, standing about 9 feet tall, with a distinct reptilian resemblance. They have 6 limbs, 2 muscular legs and arms, and a smaller set of arms. They control every aspect of their technology with their vocalizations, but over the years, they have created control panels based on their number system that allow other species to easier access elements of their technology. And there is the cutest guy of all. Look at that face. Adorable. Oh, and that's it. Well, that's the cute book. And now on to the horror book. Communication. Talking with our neighbors. We take communication for granted, even with the various languages we find here in Hunrath. But when we suddenly find ourselves among other intelligent species who don't share our culture, history, DNA, or vocal cords, it requires a huge amount of effort for the beginning of rudimentary chatting. This quick overview will set the stage for what to expect when communicating with our neighbors. Mofang. The Mofang were the first non-humans we met. With at least some level of similar physical vocal generating abilities, they picked up human words quickly. This early mimicry resulted in what the species became to be called. Even though they were able to mimic single words and simple phrases, it became evident over the years that huge grammatical differences were not easily overcome. Some have proposed that the difficulty may have arisen because the Mofang insisted on attempting to learn every human language, and as a result, were never able to lock onto any consistent grammatical structure. Nevertheless, in spite of the rudimentary sentence construction, it has been very easy to communicate, and it has been unnecessary for us to learn their language beyond a few simple phrases and proper names. If you'd like to learn more about communication with the Mofang, please contact Tam. Villian. The Villian have presented a particular communication challenge. From what we can gather, they produce sounds using 2 large reed-like structures inside opposite sides of their heads. The vibrations generated are channeled to resonance chambers in their skulls, where they are combined into a complex, low-frequency dual tone. The low-frequency bitonal sounds are not only hard for humans to hear and resolve, but impossible for us to mimic. And the Villian's hearing is also oriented toward low-frequency, so they are unable to hear most of the sounds associated with human speech. Therefore, communication with the Villian has relied on technology. They have adapted consoles, which the Villian fluently control with vocalization, for use by other species. Over the years, some individuals of other species, including a few humans, have learned to communicate very effectively using this method. Humans have been able to pick out some higher frequency characteristics of certain key Villian words over the years, and although we can't speak to them in a way that the Villians can understand, we are occasionally able to hear and recognize these words when spoken distinctly by the Villian. If you'd like to learn more about communication with the Villian, please contact Vito. Ari. None of the stages of the Arai morphology have any vocalization apparatus. Because of the obvious synchronization of the barnacle flash and the ability of the pawns to provide for and address the needs of the polyarchs, it was assumed that the species could communicate effectively. It was not until Farley began to spend large amounts of time in the polyarch antechamber that the first clues to this communication became evident. After months of research, Farley began to have limited success with receiving some kind of simple messages that were coming from the polyarchs. It is apparent now that the polyarchs had been attempting to communicate the entire time, but they themselves had been experimenting with various channels until they finally got a response from Farley. After this breakthrough, others were able to tune in to the polyarchs and learn to listen. Both the polyarchs and the pawns have a simple organ that can sense human vocal frequency, enabling them to sense simple responses from humans. But over the years, Farley was able to learn to speak to the polyarchs via a related form of extrasensory transmission. If you'd like to learn more about communication with the RI, please contact Farley. Well, no clues there, but, hey. Yeah, I can't pick up those things. Oh, well. But, hey, you know, nice little backstory lore. And now I'm just going to quickly pop over to Halford Land and see if I can't go over some of that stuff that I also read. Okay. No, I didn't find any clues in these books over here. But I did find some books. Well, I didn't find them. They were already there. But yeah, wow, that math puzzle. It's one of those that puzzles that pop up in these sorts of games. Oh boy. Don't have the brain power to do it now. I'm just hoping that there's some... I could try moving that minecart. This is the kind of fun, silly part of the episode where I do nothing of any import whatsoever and just kind of play around instead. Sound good? Awesome. Let me try to remember how the heck to get back up to that minecart. Okay, so given that I was able to switch direction, you'd think that it would be important. So as an end to the video, as one final last act of procrastination and selfing. At least it's not self-selfieing. Let's crash into a drunken pile of wine glasses because we can't see out our dang window, okay? Wham! Yeah, I don't know. I don't recall seeing any other reason why I would wish. The only thing I can see is that now I can disable this Mofang device, but like, do I really have to do that? Because that seems rather spurious to me, and it's never gonna come back if I do it, but hey, whatever. Let's see what happens. Okay, there's that Mofang device going. Yeah. Now I'll never be able to listen. So if you didn't listen at first, I guess you'll never know me. I don't own a doggy. I don't own a pony. Oh, that's some great rap lyrics there, I think. Put that in my new Southern-themed country fan album. So, however, is that... That just seems weird. I mean, these things are clearly harmless. They're just messages, but this doesn't seem the kind of game to have, like, spurious optional things. But what do I know? Maybe there are some other imager rocks around? I don't know. But, hey, you get to see me saying I don't know and act confused a lot, so bloop. That's some kind of reward. Alright. It should be... Oh, yeah, but then there's one up there by the... Maybe I am supposed to destroy all of these. Maybe, like, a pissed-off Mofang will come out at some point and say, "Hurt, what do you think you're doing, son?" And it'll advance the story and it'll be awesome. Yeah, because there's one up by the tree. I don't know if I can hit that one. But it seems... Yeah, it's seeming more and more likely, because why else would the tracks go down next to these things? You know what I'm saying? Excellent. Also, there was a barrel of oil over there. I guess that was emblematic of what was to come, and I didn't even notice. So, hey. And there's that one gone. But these aren't... Yeah, these are real rocks. Well, okay, I'm gonna see if I can't figure out how to destroy that one by the tree. I really, really, really have no idea why I'm doing this. But, hey, maybe it'll be like the only achievement in the game. And that'll be the achievement. I don't know. Or, no. Just thinking, maybe I broke something and... Maybe I broke something and was supposed to come back here to destroy those rocks, but no, because you have to go all the way through the blue stuff. I don't know. But, okay. See, this is the thing. Is there's just one last bit of track over here. And if, and I'm not sure if I can, but if this will allow me to aim up at that one by the tree, then I'll be able to destroy it. Come on, then. Not sure, though. Oh, I might... just barely be possible. I'm not sure. Let me give that a try here. Come on there. If I could just reach up. Think I hit it and absolutely nothing happened. But are these projector rocks? Not even. What about these? Funny. Oh well, I like funny. I get married to funny things every day. Some might call that gratuitous. I might call you funny for saying that. And hey, judge not lest you be judged to be a comedian, I guess. And if you're a comedian, then you can be kind of a crazy insane person who gets in trouble with the law all the time. And oh, come on, man. And nobody will care, because that's somehow just what happens. Herp-a-derp-a-derp-a-derp. So I think I'm going to end this video in shame and defeat by just kind of... Wait a minute. What if... Because this is obviously an unnecessary, silly thing. So, what if instead I can outfit this thing with a big old dynamite exploder and blow up the rocks? Also, what if I turn this whole thing around? Because this is all turned around. What if I take this thing right back into where I got it from? And then it's going to be completely in the opposite direction. And maybe, almost certainly not, but maybe... Oh, but wait. Wait, there's actually one. Dang it, there's one Mofang disabler device that I missed. Okay, well, never mind. I'll do that later. First of all, yeah, there's the thing right at the entrance to the canyon. I could blow that up if that is indeed what you're supposed to do. But not gonna try, because I think I might have to turn the entire thing around for that. Oh, this is the wrong way. Unfortunate. Weird. Right, because first of all, there's this switch, which... Why would that be there? Because there's this wall here. And... secondly, yeah, if I just put it back where I found it, I mean, I just don't know why else I would want to turn this around, but... That's just the mystery of life. It's literally the mystery of life, so okay. Oh, I can't do that, can I? Well, so much for that. Right, well, there's the last one, so... It really doesn't seem like anything's gonna happen, but... Confusion breeds complacency, or... possibly victory. It's not gonna happen. I hope I could destroy it, because shooting stuff at stuff is... what I'm best at. I definitely like to imitate my idols, and... then I surpass them, and... act smug about it. Did I... Ugh. not the most non-inglorious end. But well, that's it. That's all, folks. So see you guys next time when I write down some base 3 math, and bye for now.